Okay, good morning, friends. Yesterday we started with the subject. We discussed the word cost. Using this, we discussed cost sheet, isn't it? Cost sheet, we discussed three types. One was simple one, without stock adjustment. Another was with stock adjustment. And third one was revised cost sheet by the institute, right, by ICAI. They follow their own path. This one is the standard cost sheet, which is used at most of the places, right, this one. Can you revise this cost sheet with me? Yes. Cost sheet with stock adjustment, if you remember, and if you have done some revision at home, let's go. First is direct material consumed, which can be calculated as opening stock of raw material, add purchases of raw material minus closing stock of raw material. Very good, that is consumption. Add direct wages, add direct expenses if given, rarely given. So you'll get prime cost. Then add factory overheads, you will get gross factory cost. Gross factory cost. Add opening WIP less closing WIP, we get net factory cost of finished goods produced. Then we add administration overheads, we get cost of production, naturally of finished goods. Add opening stock of finished goods less closing stock of finished goods, we get cost of goods sold. Add selling and distribution overheads, we get cost of sales compared with sales, difference is profit or loss. Fantastic, very nice. Then we had seen this revised cost sheet in which one word was left to be discussed. Do you remember? Primary packing. I think rest of the things I have discussed with you from the revised cost sheet. Some new items were there. I think page number 14. 1-4. Out of the new items which institute has added in the cost sheet, there was one word to be discussed, primary packing. So I'll discuss both primary and secondary packing cost. Primary and secondary packing cost. You will notice this primary packing cost is written along with administration overheads, is it? Below in the list of administration overheads. And before we add administration overheads, you get net factory cost of finished goods produced. So after that, this is added. We'll discuss the logic behind it, why institute did it so, and what is the difference between primary packing and secondary packing. Now let us imagine, any product when manufactured should be packed before it is delivered to the customer. Now we'll take an example. When we buy medicines, when you buy medicine, that medicine comes in that aluminium foil. Generally 10 tablets will or 10 capsules will come in an aluminium foil generally. Okay, this packing which is required to preserve the quality of goods, the packing which is required to preserve the quality of goods, and the packing along with which the goods are given to the customer, that packing is primary packing. That is that aluminium foil in which the medicines are packed. See, you cannot sell the medicine loose like this, right? A medical shopkeeper doesn't tell you, okay, you want two medicines, so loose medicines. We won't buy it because it should not touch human hands. So it comes in that packing is primary. But you will notice that shopkeeper, he might be taking out that strip of medicine from a small box, correct? So in the small box, there might be some 10, 15, 20 strips out of which one he has taken and given to you. That is also packing, that small box. That packing is secondary. Secondary packing is the packing done for the convenience of handling, material handling. Material handling means usko rakhna, uthana, uske liye easy hona chahiye. So secondary packing is for the convenience of material handling and for transportation. That packing is called secondary packing. And packing done to preserve the quality of goods is primary packing. This is compulsory packing. This is optional, you can say, secondary. That small box, that cost is secondary. And if you visit the factory where these medicines are manufactured, factory where medicines are manufactured, do you think they might be selling these medicines in these small, small boxes? If they have to send the truckload of medicine, can they send in these small boxes? No. So these small, small boxes are further packed in a big corrugated box. That is called as corrugated box, a big box in which small, small boxes might have been packed so that you can easily transport, you can easily handle, load, unload. So all these packings done subsequently is called secondary packing. Now company is definitely incurring the cost on secondary packing also and primary packing also. Primary packing reaches to the customer, but secondary packings are taken out. Like wholesaler will dump that corrugated box and will sell the retailer in small boxes. The retailer will dump small boxes and will hand over you only strip. So the strip which comes with the packing, that is primary, and all others were secondary. This much is understood. Now this primary packing will be done for work in progress goods or finished goods?
Finished.
Naturally finished goods. And that is the reason they have added in the net factory cost of finished goods. Because primary packing cost will be incurred after goods are finished. It is not incurred for WIP. When goods are not yet fully manufactured, how you can incur primary packing? How you can pack? Packing is last stage. Because now it is ready for delivery. So this primary packing is added along with administration overheads. That is after net factory cost. Correct? Now institute has not written secondary packing. But let me tell you where secondary packing goes then. Because they have not used the word secondary packing. I have kept the format as it is. Secondary packing forms part of selling and distribution overheads. Because secondary packing is required only for transportation and handling. So secondary packing is not treated as part of production cost. Secondary packing is treated as a selling and distribution overheads. So in selling and distribution overheads, you include secondary packing. And primary packing is included in calculation of production cost, correct? So that is the difference. I think this was the only word left to be discussed. And today we have to move to the word costing. Very good. So I'll take you to costing now. This was yesterday's quick revision. Now the difference between the word cost and costing. Someone may say the difference is of ing. That is definitely a difference in spelling. But in meaning there is a lot of difference. I'll just rub this off. So we'll go entirely for costing. I'm taking it away. This will again be discussed. This primary secondary packing will come for discussion once again, but in the topic of overheads. When we'll touch the topic overheads, we'll go once again. So let's go to costing. Now, if I ask you a question, have you incurred some cost so far in the journey of becoming chartered accountant?
Yes.
Definitely yes. Because you are already in the second stage. You have already cleared either CPT or foundation or graduation. So some cost is incurred for that. And now you are in intermediate. So some cost is already incurred in intermediate and some cost will be incurred for CA final before you become finished goods. So some cost is already incurred. How much? I hope you got my question. How much is incurred? Okay, now naturally I know your answer. You will say that give this assignment as a homework today. So that by tomorrow we'll come with the answer, isn't it? So you have to calculate that cost. You have already incurred that cost, but you have not yet calculated that cost because you'll have to do it very carefully. Now understand two words, cost incurred. The spelling is cost incurred. And cost is ascertained. Cost incurred and cost ascertained. There is a difference between the two words. cost incurred yani kharcha laga, cost ascertained yani kitna laga calculate kiya. It means to ascertain the cost. The meaning of the word to ascertain means to calculate. To ascertain means to calculate. Cost is incurred yani kharcha laga kitna. So you have to calculate. The method or the process through which we ascertain cost is called costing. Costing is the process of ascertainment of cost. Costing is the process or the technique of ascertainment of cost. Cost calculate karne ka tarika. Cost calculate karne ka tarika. The way, the process through which you will ascertain the cost is called costing. Definition, then we'll go into details. Now we have variety of industries in real life. For example, teaching is one industry, aviation could be another industry, steel manufacturing is another industry, cement manufacturing is another industry, software is another industry, bank is another industry, n numbers, transportation is another industry, so many. We have so many industries in real life. Do you think for any industry I can calculate the cost using a single way? Means there will be only one formula or one way through which I can calculate cost of manufacture of cement also, and using same approach I can calculate cost of manufacture of software also? Naturally not. Very logical, very good students. It means there should be different ways to calculate the cost for different industries. Very good. And there we go. These are known as different methods of costing. Different methods of costing mean different ways of ascertainment of cost. Costing is ascertainment of cost, and to ascertain means to calculate the cost. But there has to be a way to calculate the cost. The way to calculate the cost could be different. So we are going to study different methods of costing depending upon different industries. In different industries you have to apply different methods. So depending upon variety of industries, the methods are divided in few. So I will write few names of the methods of costing. One is job costing. Another method is batch costing, contract costing, single output or unit costing, process costing, joint product, byproduct costing, which is linked with this topic, operating costing and multiple costing. These names are printed also somewhere. Only I will discuss in my own sequence. They are printed somewhere, something earlier, something later, but it is printed. These are different methods of costing. Now let us discuss one by one. So it will take you through different industries. Indirectly, we will be traveling through variety of industries through this. I will touch the first one, job costing. Okay, some of you are noting down, no problem. That is always your choice what to take down from here. Costing is ascertainment of cost. One more thing, ascertainment of cost also helps you to ascertain profit or loss. See, if I am able to ascertain or calculate cost of this marker pen and I will sell it at X price, that difference between sales price and cost will be my profit or loss. So, ascertainment of cost always helps you to ascertain profit or loss. So, ascertainment of profit or loss becomes a secondary, which can be calculated automatically if you are able to ascertain cost. So, costing is ascertainment of cost. If I am interested in ascertaining the cost of a job, then it is job costing. Now, we will explain that. If I am interested in ascertaining cost of a batch, then it is batch costing. If I am interested in ascertaining cost of a contract, I am using contract costing, and so on. So, everywhere costing word is common. I have to discuss the first word, letters. Here, this job doesn't mean the job which you are going to join after becoming CA. That is not the meaning, because you may mistake this job as the job which you will join. No. Here, job means the order which you receive from customer. So, the order which you receive from customer is called as job. And I'll go to little more details. Job costing method is used in a jobbing industry, and jobbing industry is one where goods are produced or services are provided as per the specific needs and requirement of customer. I repeat once again, jobbing industry is one where goods are produced or services are provided as per the specific needs and requirement of customer. Any such industry is called jobbing industry, and the work which you receive from the customer is called job, and you have to ascertain cost of that job, for which we use job costing. Now, naturally, we have to take example. Suppose I am a furniture manufacturer. But I don't sell ready-made furniture. I sell furniture made as per requirement of customer. Are you getting my point? I have received the order from three customers. One customer is the coaching institution who gave me the order for desk benches. Another customer is a medical shopkeeper who has purchased a new shop. Now, you know, in medical shop, you need those drawers and small shelves to store the medicine and showcase and all. So, that shopkeeper who has purchased a new shop want me to manufacture the furniture for his shop. Third person, third customer, C, he has purchased a new house, residential house. Now, in residential house also, we need furniture. You need bed, right? You need cupboards, right? You need sofa set and whatnot, right? So, furniture required for household use. So, he want me to manufacture that furniture. So, the three customers, can I quote them same sales price? Naturally not, because all these three are different orders. The cost incurred for A, for B, for C will be different. Price quoted to A, B, C will be different. This each order received from customer is called as job order. What it is called as? Job order. Order received from customer is job. So, it is called job order. So, I have received three orders. Now, I am interested in knowing the profit or loss which I have made on these orders. I will first give them the quotation. I will do some estimation first. What will be my cost to complete this work? I will add my profit, estimated profit, and I will provide a quotation. You know that. If the customer likes the quotation, then he will give me the orders. Suppose I have received the confirmed orders from all the three and the work has started. Now, these work are different from each other, and these work will, all these jobs will be executed as per the specific need and requirement of customer. So, it's an example of jobbing industry. Now, I am interested in knowing the cost incurred on each job as well as profit earned on each job. So, I have to maintain job-wise record. If I don't maintain job-wise record, how I will get the cost of every job and profit or loss on every job? So when I maintain job-wise record, I am using job costing, and I have to maintain job-wise records. So suppose I prepare one account, job A account, that is for customer A. Your costing is cost accounting only. So it has got lot of connection with accounting, right? And later on also I will go on connecting you. Accounts gets connected to costing, but there is some difference between financial accounting, cost accounting, and difference between cost accounting and management accounting. So we'll be discussing it little later, right? All the three. So it's a account, ledger account. Whatever cost is incurred to complete this job, you will debit all the cost here. And practically there are three elements of cost, practically: material, labor, overheads, practically. And that is what is most of the time used. So we'll be talking about these three only. So you'll debit the material cost here, labor cost here, overheads cost here. For job B, you will open separate account. You will debit the cost of job B separately, job C separately. So you are maintaining job wise record. So you are using job costing. And if I take my revenue here, which I have earned from the customer, the difference will be profit or loss. It is so simple only. So maintaining job wise record means using job costing. This is just a first introduction. This first chapter, basic concept is like pahli pahli mulaqat. Yes, first chapter is just pahli mulaqat, right? When you come to the classroom, you meet new friends for the first time. So you ask only the name, first day. Second day, you may ask from where you are, right? Third day, who is your father, right? Mother, how many brothers, sisters? And once you develop the friendship over a period of time, and you visit the house of that friend, then you even know the cats and dogs which are there, right, in their family. The dog will first bark on you because you are unknown. But once you have visited 4-5 times, next time he comes to you. It means you get habituated and familiarized with everything. Exactly same thing we'll be doing in costing. First chapter is just a brief introduction of so many chapters in basic concept, because you should know the word first. And later on, we are going to visit everybody's house. और फिर इतनी डिटेल पहचान हो जाना चाहिए कि कुत्ता भौंके नहीं, आपके पास है, पूछ ही लाए. आई होप यू गॉट इट. रीजन आई एम सेइंग दिस आर ऑल चैप्टर्स इन योर सिलेबस, आई एम जस्ट इंट्रोड्यूसिंग यू विद देम. इट इज ओनली द फर्स्ट इंट्रोडक्शन. सो डोंट अज्यूम दैट एवरीथिंग यू विल अंडरस्टैंड राइट नाउ. इट इज जस्ट फर्स्ट इंट्रोडक्शन. लेटर ऑन विल विजिट एवरी चैप्टर इन डिटेल, because that is what is your subject. Indirectly, I have made a list of all the chapters which you are going to study in days to come. Okay, so only this much I am discussing at present. Job wise record is job costing, and jobbing industry is one where goods are produced or services are provided as per the specific needs and requirement of customer. I move to batch costing. Batch costing is used in an industry where goods are manufactured in batches. Batches means lots. In one batch, you manufacture exactly identical goods. In one batch, you manufacture exactly identical. Identical means exactly same. There's a difference between two words, similar and identical. Similar means looking similar, but it's not exactly same. Identical means exactly same. So when exactly identical goods are manufactured in a lot, that is in a batch, then we have to maintain batch wise record, and all such industries are using batch costing. Example, again we'll take a medicine. Whenever you buy medicine, you will notice on that strip they write the month and year of manufacture, expiry date, batch number is also written. Always. Medicines are always manufactured in batches. Actually, all industries where goods are either perishable or having short shelf life. What do you mean by short shelf life? You cannot store it eternally, right? They will get expired, outdated after some time. In all such industries, you manufacture the goods in batches, like medicine, breads, biscuits, you are ready to eat snacks. So they are not manufactured continuously. What they do, they manufacture one batch. Once it gets sold, then one more batch. So you have to keep manufacturing fresh. Once that is sold again, another manufacturer. Like bread, bread is manufactured every day. So anyway, all such industries use batch costing where goods are manufactured in lots or in batches. I took the example of a medicine. Suppose in one batch we have produced 50,000 capsules. In one lot or in one batch we have produced 50,000 capsules of a particular medicine. So we'll open like this only. We'll open a batch account. So I'll just change the word. Instead of job account, we'll write batch account. Remaining is same, and I will debit the cost. Cost incurred on this batch of medicine manufacturing 50,000 identical capsules, material, labor, overheads. These three are our next three chapters, huh? Yeah. After basic concept discussion, next three chapters are material, labor, overheads only. So this also we are going to visit in detail. Material, labor, overheads, our next three chapters. After these, then this will start. Anyway, so you calculated the cost, you have written material, labor and overheads cost, and suppose it comes to 1,50,000. Simple figure I am taking, total. Total cost of 50,000 capsules is 1,50,000. Now can we calculate cost per capsule? Very easily. 1,50,000 divided by 50,000, because all 50,000 capsules are identical. Cost per capsule is?
3
rupees. But we sell it in a strip of 10 capsules. We sell it in a strip of 10 capsules. So our sales unit is of 10 capsules. So what we'll do? 3 capsules into 10. 30 rupees is cost per strip. Now I want profit 20 rupees. So 30 rupees is the cost to me. 20 rupees is my desired profit. So I will add 20 rupees. My selling price is 50. 50 rupees is selling price. And suppose 10% is GST, which government want. I don't want it, government want it. So 50 rupees plus 10%, 55 rupees is my MRP, maximum retail price. This is how it is calculated. I hope you are getting it now. For one batch, cost was 1,50,000, because, and how I could get this cost? Because I maintained the record batch wise. When I will produce next batch after some time, I will prepare another account, like batch 1 account, batch 2 account, batch 3 account. Yes, for this batch, this is the cost. Per unit cost is 3, cost of 10 capsules is 30, because that is my sales unit. I have added my profit 20, that is 50 rupees is my selling price, plus 10% GST, just for example, 55 rupees is MRP. So I will collect 55 from customer, 5 rupees I will pay to government, that is not my money. 50 rupees will go to my pocket, out of which 30 I have incurred cost, 20 is my profit. Naturally, the fees which is collected from you also, it includes 18% GST. So that 18% won't come to us. It will come to us, but it will go to government immediately. And if we delay in making the payment of GST, we have to pay along with interest and penalty. That we have to pay out of our own pocket. Because we are holding back whose money? Government's money. It is government's money and we are using. We are not paying to government, then pay interest also, penalty also and GST also. So that's government money. It's everywhere, in every business. When you will become chartered accountant, you will start earning the money, you will have to pay income tax. But income tax is called direct tax. And this GST is called indirect tax. I won't go further because that is your another subject for 100 marks, right? The difference between direct and indirect. Anyway, but it was required here also to calculate MRP. All such industries use batch costing, pharmaceutical, I said, breads, biscuits, snacks and so many. Wherever you notice batch number, you will find batch costing. So batch costing is just a small variation of job costing. Similarly, contract costing is also a variation of job costing. I mean, they are similar. They are not identical. Job costing is similar to batch costing and similar to contract costing. But the difference is, in contract costing, first of all, this method of costing is used for contractors. This method of costing is used for contractors. Suppose I am a contractor who undertakes constructional contracts, constructional, engineering, mechanical contracts, erectional contracts, then I will use contract costing. So, suppose I got a contract to construct a flyover bridge in Pune from government. Then I need to calculate how much profit I have earned or loss I have suffered on construction of that bridge. In Pune, that metro work is also going on. So, some company must have got that work to do the construction of metro railway. So, I have got the contract of construction of a flyover bridge, and this contract is worth 250 crores. The contract is worth 250 crores, but it will take 5 years to execute that contract. It will take 5 years to execute the contract. I want to calculate profit or loss on that contract. Now, actual profit or loss I can calculate only after 5 years. Naturally, when contract will get completed, then only I will come to know the actual cost incurred. Compared with 250 crore revenue, difference is profit or loss. But I think the statutory authorities will require me to calculate profit every year, because like income tax return you file every year. So, I need to close the books of account every year and report the profit or loss. But first year when I close the books, the contract is incomplete. How to calculate profit or loss on incomplete contract then? I hope you are getting my point. How to calculate profit or loss on incomplete contract? That is what you are going to learn in contract costing. Otherwise, contract is very similar to job, because contract is executed as per the need and requirement of customer only. Because customer has to tell me what is to be done, then I will execute. So, contract satisfies the criteria of job. But then why there are two different methods? Due to time duration. We use job costing when the duration is few days, few weeks or few months. And when the duration goes beyond 1 year, we use contract costing. I will just say, a long-term duration job is a contract. A job with long-term duration of more than 1 year becomes a contract. Simple. Otherwise, they are very similar. Longer the duration, exceeding 1 year, contract costing. Shorter the duration, job costing. And here also you maintain contract wise record, you will prepare contract account, and then we will learn the tricks and techniques how incomplete contract can be closed for books of accounts. Contract is not complete in year 1, year 2, year 3, year 4, it is incomplete, but still incomplete contracts you can close in the books of accounts to calculate the cost and calculate the profit. How to do it? To be discussed in contract costing. I move ahead. Single output, also known as unit costing, means single output costing, unit costing. Sometimes people just call output costing or single costing. Lot many words are used, single costing or single output costing, single unit costing and so on, all permutations and combinations. This is the simplest method of costing in the entire syllabus, and therefore Institute has never asked a question on this so far. I have seen in such a long history of the Institute, never asked a question. I will tell you why and where this method is used. This method of costing is used in an industry where you manufacture only single product, only one product. That one product is identical throughout the year you manufacture one product. No change in size, no change in shape, no change in color, nothing. Only one product, identical, manufactured throughout the year. Such industry, in such industry we use single output costing. Now, first of all, it is difficult to imagine such industry. Only single product, identical I am saying, no change in size, shape, color also. Pain. Somebody said, pen, I think you have variety of pens manufactured by one company. Variety of pens or variety of colors also. I am saying no change in size, shape, color, nothing. Only one
product. Identical. Identical and similar is different. Now, car manufacturers, scooter manufacturers, they have variety of models. I am saying only one product, identical throughout the year. It's difficult to imagine because no industry can survive on one product. However, there are examples. Let us say, we purchase electricity. No? Yes, we purchase electricity. I purchase electricity of A quality. Which one you purchase? I think all of us purchase same. So, electricity generating company. Naturally, there are power generation plants, that is electricity generating companies. They manufacture same electricity throughout the year. No change. Now, they want to calculate cost per unit of electricity generated. Cost per unit. First of all, in electricity manufacture, this one unit is called as 1 kWh. For your information, we will need this kilowatt hour. Means the unit of measuring the electricity is kilowatt hour. Short form is kWh. Right? So when we say this month we have consumed 500 units of electricity, which is reflected in our electricity bill. The 500 units consumed is 500 kilowatt hour. That is the unit for measuring electricity. Now, electricity generating companies manufacturing day in day out electricity, and they are interested in calculating cost per kilowatt hour of electricity, means cost per unit. What they can do simply, at the end of the year, take the total cost incurred. So numerator is total cost, denominator is total output. Total output means total electricity generated in units. I think total cost divided by total output, can you get cost per unit?
Yes.
That's all. Over. It's how simple it is. Because you are producing only one product, so all cost incurred is for this only. So total cost divided by total output, and you will get cost per unit of output. Only this formula is there in this chapter. Only one formula. Cost per unit is equal to total cost divided by total output, because single output industry. Now, why institute did not ask the question in the exam so far? This figure they have to give in the question paper. This figure also they have to provide in the question paper. And calculators are allowed. So what you have to do then? What grade you will do? Therefore, they have never ever asked this. On the contrary, this chapter is missing itself. You will just find one few lines and one reference, and this, there is no separate chapter on this because there is nothing to write there. But this method has a limited use for such industries. One more example I will give. Collieries. Collieries means from these are coal mines from where coal is extracted. It's called collieries. Right? So suppose, and we have to pay royalty to the government to get the license to extract the coal from a particular region, from a particular area. Because anything extracted from earth, the ownership belongs to government. So, if you want to do it legally, then pay them royalty. It's their property. Pay them royalty and then extract. So, we are doing legal business. So, we have paid the license fees or royalty to the government, and we have been allotted a block of, let us say, 10 square kilometers. And in that 10 square kilometer, we can do the mining. And the coal is found in that area. So, we have to extract the coal and sell it to the industry who requires coal. So, day in, day out, my equipments, you know, earth moving equipments, which we call it as JCB. They are called earth moving equipments. That is a technical name, earth moving equipments, huge machineries. So, my earth moving equipments are taking out the coal and we are selling. Now, I think the coal has varieties. Yeah, coal has different varieties, different grades. But in that area, I find only B grade of coal. So, day in, day out, I am extracting coal and selling. So, it's only one product. Not manufactured also, it is extracted. If I want to calculate cost per ton of coal extracted, because I have to decide the selling price, I think it's very easy. Total cost incurred during the year in the entire organization divided by total tons of coal extracted during the year. Already, cost per ton of coal extracted available. Just I gave you another example, so it's very, very simple, right? Therefore, not asked. Now we move to process costing, and then these two are connected with each other. It's an interesting thing. Any industry where goods are manufactured in different stages, these different stages of production is called process, means different steps. For example, raw material will go to first process A, processing is done. Then it will go to process B, some processing is done, then it will go to process C, and let us assume that is last process. So at the end of process C, you will get finished goods. The basic characteristic of process costing is, first of all, there is a continuous production. Production is continuous in processing industry, and output of previous process becomes input for next process. These are few characteristics of processing industry. In such industry, we use process costing. First, we'll take your example. Your first process was foundation or CPT. Second processing is going on, intermediate. Final processing, CA final, then finished product, chartered accountant, correct? So you will be processed in three stages. But let's take a real life example. We'll take a sweet example. Sugar. Sweet example of sugar. Sugar is manufactured in processing industry. Right? As I have visited the sugar factory, I can tell you with more confidence. One thing got recalled to me. As our subject of costing is closely linked to manufacturing industry, very closely linked. To understand what I'm saying, you'll have to imagine a manufacturing industry. Means daily when you are sitting in the classroom, you have to imagine a manufacturing process, then you can correlate nicely. Now most of us, you and me included, we don't have much exposure to manufacturing. Now, we don't have much exposure to manufacturing sector, but the subject is related to manufacturing. So what can be done? Technology can be used. YouTube. You people have been using YouTube for a variety of reasons, but can it be used for studies? Yes. From someone I came to know that there used to be a program on television which was called as Factory Made, where this manufacturing was shown. I've got a very close eye, my dear friends, and I've told you I'm like a coconut. Very hard from outside. Don't play with the fire. You'll get burnt. It's first warning. Those who are interested in studies will only attend the lectures. Remaining will stay outside. I can see till that corner. Come back. I was on sweet example and there was a bitter test. Right, we were on sugar factory, right? I was trying to give you the example. Before that I said that there used to be a program on television called Factory Made, where they used to show the videos of different factories, how the manufacturing is done. And these videos are also available on YouTube. So if you just type Factory Made, not here. Here it is not allowed. Whenever time permits, you go back home. You can treat it as a homework. This will add knowledge to you. Now we see variety of unrelated things on YouTube which will not add any knowledge. Better you can use it for knowledge gaining. So without visiting a factory is not that easy. We'll have to go there, actually take their permission and spend the time. Just sitting at home, in few minutes you can see the manufacturing process nicely recorded. So you can see variety of industries and variety of manufacturing processes to gain some knowledge. Okay, so that is a way out Today it is available. In our days it was not available, my dear friends. So you are fortunate people. But use all the technology, make use of technology for our benefit, right? And before I go to this, again something got clicked to my mind from technology only. This mobile is a great technology, right? Even I use it, but it can be misused. Today, what has happened, you will see else everywhere, that we have become slaves of mobile. Almost, we have become slaves of mobile. We cannot stay without mobile. We can stay without lunch and dinner once, but we cannot stay without mobile. We have become so much addicted. We have reached to a level of addiction. Some of the people have already reached to that level of addiction. I assume, fortunately, you have not reached to that level. And if you have reached to, I am here to cure. I won't allow you to touch for at least 2 hours. Please make mobile your slave. Don't become slave of mobile. As simple as that. It means we should use mobile when we need it. Don't allow mobile to use us. There is a difference between the two. Don't allow mobile to use us. We should use mobile as and when it is needed. It's a small difference. Understand it very well, because especially for new generation, I have seen, young generation, you people are reaching to the level of addiction. We are not, because we never used it. So we use it only for the purpose when it is required. I've seen few people, every second, even while walking on the road, the truck is coming from the front, but then there's no attention there, because every attention is here, and then you fall down, right? You hit something. That level of addiction you will find very easily. People are driving two-wheeler, one hand is here, one hand is here, and the Pune traffic, where you will go? Either hospital or upstairs. This is the level of addiction. So if you want to become chartered accountant, one big hurdle between you and a qualification of CA is mobile. And if you have, some of you might be having that addiction, if you have identified that this is something which is standing in between me and my qualification, please remove this hurdle, please remove this speed breaker, and I will help you to do that. Try to stay away from it. Use it, no doubt, we should have it. It's a good technology. Anyway, this lecture I gave based on technology, right? Use technology, no doubt about it. But don't become slave of technology. Anyway, come back. So, today's homework is YouTube, factory made only. Because once you open it, you will go elsewhere. See few manufacturing industries. Anyway, come back. Process costing. Sugar factory, which I had physically visited in the course of audit. So, I am just explaining. The first process in sugar factory is crushing. Crushing. Naturally, sugar cane is crushed in huge machineries. We see that in the summer season also, when we drink the sugar cane juice, how it has been crushed. But the machinery size is very big. Sugar cane is crushed and sugar cane juice is extracted from the crushing process. So the output of first process is sugar cane juice. This goes to second process. Second process is boiling and cleaning. Boiling and cleaning. Hum ghar pe doodh tapate na? In the similar manner, this sugar cane juice is poured into big containers. You can call it as kadhai, right? Big containers. And with the help of chemical, naturally you have to boil it with the fire, and some chemicals are added to purify it. That is boiling and cleaning. And the impurities are removed in the boiling and cleaning process. Hum jaise doodh ki malai nikalte na, waise some impurities are removed. We'll discuss more later. So that is boiling and cleaning process. Cleaned juice goes to third process. And this is the main process. This is called crystallization. This is called crystallization. See, sugar we get in crystals, that is granules or small crystals. Now, this blackish or greenish juice is converted into white sugar crystals. How this happens? So, this happens over different stages. So, process is crystallization. In crystallization process, you have different chambers. So, that juice passes through different chambers, And as it passes through different chambers, it becomes thicker and thicker, whiter and whiter, slowly. It's a lengthiest process and costliest process. Liquid getting converted into solid, blackish greenish getting converted into white. So this process is the lengthiest or costliest process. And at the end of crystallization process, you find the white sugar coming out from the machine, from the chamber. And so last process is weighing and packing. Generally, sugar is packed in 1 quintal bags. 1 quintal is?
100 kg.
Very good. 100 kg is 1 quintal. And 1 ton?
1,000 kg.
Very nice. Very intelligent students, right? Because sometimes people don't know what is 1 quintal and 1 ton. 1 ton is 1,000 kg. 1 quintal is 100 kg. So generally, sugar is sold in those jute bags of 100 kg, 1 quintal. So there is a weighing machine kept. They catch the sugar in that jute bag. Weight 100 kg, put another bag. The moment 100 kg is there, that is weighing, and then there is a handheld stitching machine. It is stitched. So it is packed and it is sent to the finished goods godown, from where it will be sold to the wholesalers. So in 4 processes, your finished product is ready. Crushing, boiling and cleaning, crystallization, weighing and packing is the last process. So through these 4 processes, sugar gets produced. Now, we'll call this process as A, B, C, D. You have to maintain the costing records process-wise. It's for each process. So, I'll maintain process A account, process B account, process C account, process D account, naturally. So that I will come to know how much cost is incurred at stage 1, that is process A stage, stage 2, stage 3, stage 4 and so on. And output of every process will get transferred to next process. So when we calculate the cost process wise, we use process costing. Now the connected topic to process costing is joint product byproduct costing. Yesterday also one word had come in the revised cost sheet. If you remember, sale of byproducts, scraps, that word has come. And that is an income, right, when we sell. So now I'll discuss in brief joint product and byproduct. When in a processing industry, as I said, these topics are connected. When in a processing industry, from one process, you get multiple products. Process is one, but products are not one, products are multiple. Those multiple products manufactured from a single process or from a common process, these multiple products are called as either joint products or byproducts. Together they are called joint products and byproducts. Sugar factory is one example. I'll give you other example also. Now, before that, let us assume that this is a process account. So, I have prepared process, let us say, A account. This is the cost incurred again, material, labor and overheads. But the output from this process is, there are 3 outputs, let us say, A, B and C. These are 3 outputs emerging from common process, emerging from common process. These A, B, C which are produced jointly are called as joint products and byproducts. Then we will see the difference between joint product and byproduct, but together they are called joint products and byproducts. Now the problem is, I have maintained process wise account. I came to know the cost of this process 1,50,000. But problem is, out of 1,50,000, what is the cost of A, what is the cost of B and what is the cost of C? You will say simple, 3 products, 1,50,000 divided by 3. If it would have been so simple, then this chapter will get deleted. The quantity produced of all these 3 could be different. Do you think all these 3 will get produced in same quantity? No. The market value of these 3 products could be different. So when quantity is different, market value is different, you cannot just say 1,50,000 divided by 3. So we should have some logical approach, logical way of distributing this common cost between these joint products and byproducts. Exactly same thing we'll be studying here. So whole of this chapter is related to what? That how this joint processing cost should be distributed logically, equitably between joint products and byproducts. That is the whole purpose this chapter is designed. So this will be used in those processing industries where you get multiple products together from a common process. And I'll continue with sugar factory, and we'll have to see the difference also between these two. Out of ABC, let us assume A and B are your main products. Main products means they generate majority of your revenue. The market value of A and B is much higher, but market value of C is very low. But it is not a wastage. It is not a wastage. You will not throw it. It will get sold in the market. But it is not a wastage. It has a value. It has a name. It has a value. But as compared to AB, it has got very low value. In that case, we will call A and B as joint product and C will call byproduct. Simple. So the main products which are intentionally produced are joint products. Byproducts are having low value and they get produced automatically in the process, whether you want to produce them or you don't want to produce them, but they will arise and they will fetch you very low value. Then we call them as byproducts. But together we call joint product, byproduct, because all of them arise jointly. Now in sugar factory we'll compare. In sugar factory your main product is only one, that is sugar. But in the process of manufacture of sugar we get lot of byproducts. So let us see how. First process, crushing. Just imagine if you are crushing sugarcane juice is extracted, but something is left. Hum kachra bolte usko. That leftover in crushing process, which you see when you have the sugarcane juice, that leftover, people call it is wastage, it is kachra, it has got a name, it is called bagasse. It is called bagasse. Right. That is a technical name because it's a product. But do you think it will fetch as much value as sugar? No. On the contrary, when 100 tons of sugar cane is crushed, 100 tons, sugar cane juice is only 10 tons. 90 tons is bagasse. It means 90% of input gets wasted, and that is bagasse. However, bagasse is a product and it gets sold. People don't throw it. So I'll tell you what happens to bagasse later on, just as an information. But bagasse is an example of byproduct arising from crushing process. From crushing process, two things arise: juice and bagasse. Out of which I am talking about bagasse just for information. One thing is bagasse is dried in the sunlight in open grounds. Once it gets dried, you can burn it. It is a good fuel. Like we burn wood to generate fire, it can be burnt and it generates the fire. So all sugar factories, they use this bagasse to generate fire. Now fire is generated in furnaces. Nayne naam bolte jaunga main. Furnace ne industrial chula, bhatti. It's called furnace. Big bhatti is furnace. So in that furnace, this bagasse is burnt. Fire is generated and water is boiled. I don't joke. I never lie. Listen further. Water is boiled in that furnace using bagasse. Bagasse is used as a fuel. Water is boiled. Boiling the water will generate steam. That steam is passed through turbines. There is an equipment called turbine. The force of steam rotates the turbine, and rotation of turbine generates the electricity. This process of electricity generation is called thermal power. This process of generating electricity from steam is known as thermal power. all sugar factories in India, almost all, they generate their own power. And on that power, the factory is running. Because the bagasse is produced in such a huge quantity, they have more than enough bagasse. So all of them, they generate their own electricity to run their own factory. Plus, bagasse is still left. The leftover bagasse is packed using a hydraulic press machine. They press it and then there is a stripping machine through which they pack it and they make the bundles. We call them as bales, B-A-L-E-S, bales. And they are sold to paper industries. Whom? Paper industries. Extra bagasse is sold to paper industries. Some bagasse is used for generation of electricity. Bagasse is sold to paper factories. What paper factories do? Paper industries, they collect this bagasse, waste paper, wood, and using all this mixture, they manufacture paper pulp. It is first called paper pulp. And when paper pulp is sprayed on hot rollers, there are rollers and the paper pulp is sprayed over hot rollers, it gets converted into paper. So for paper industry, it is a raw material. Yes, bagasse is a raw material for whom? Paper industry. So they buy it from you, they pay you some money, it gets sold, you recover some money by selling byproduct. So one more example, I'll continue. This was crushing process, boiling and cleaning. Interesting. Some of you must be aware of, those who are coming from villages where sugar factories are located, they know all this. But others should also know. This boiling and cleaning, where I said the impurities are removed. Aur doodh tapate samay malai aati bola tha na? Similarly, when you boil this and using chemicals, when you clean it, the impurities are removed and kept at one place. Cleaned juice is passed on to third process. And these impurities which are removed in the boiling and cleaning process is just kept at one place. This impurities is known as molasses. Somewhere I have written it in the notes. If you read it carefully at home, you will find somewhere it is written. First one was bagasse. This was bagasse. Now what we are getting, that impurity is molasses. It's a name. I have not kept that name. Right? So don't blame me. Right? It's in the industry, it is known as molasses. There's a very stinking smell of molasses. It's written. Yeah. Molasses is also written, right? I think that bagasse is B-A-G-G-E-S-S-E, bagasse, right? It's written there, don't worry. And molasses, right? M-O-L-A, something, S-S-E, molasses, S-S-E-S, it's written. If not here, it must be written there in this chapter, where? Joint product, byproduct costing, don't worry. Now this molasses is very interesting. This molasses has a very stinking smell. Very stinking smell. Actually, the smell is the smell gets spread over around a radius of 2 to 3 kilometers. Right? It is so strong. When you reach near the sugar factory within a 2-3 kilometer radius, you start having that smell. That smell is of that molasses. So when I visited the factory, I told that factory supervisor, ye baas maar raha hai, isko phek do na. Baas maarne wala item hai na. Stinking smell, throw it. He said, sir, kaam ki cheez hai, aise kaise phek de? Right, because it is having some utility. I said, what this wastage is having utility? He said, sir, this molasses is sold to distilleries. Some everyday new words. What I said? Distillery is another industry. I'm coming to it. There is a lot to learn here. And everything is new every day. So molasses is an input raw material for distillery. Distillery is an industry. What they do, I'm coming to it. Why it is called distillery? Because the process there is called distillation. Distillation is the process which is carried out on molasses. Therefore, they are called distillery. So, distilleries buy the molasses from sugar factories. And through distillation process, It is converted into alcohol. I'm not joking. Molasses through distillation process is converted into alcohol. And alcohol by further processing can be converted into liquor for human consumption, can be converted into ethanol. Ethanol, right? Search all the spellings, right? Today's homework, right? What is distillery? What is ethanol? Ethanol is mixed with petrol. It's a good fuel. When you buy petrol, some percentage is ethanol, which is mixed with the petrol. It's a very good fuel, clean fuel. It doesn't generate carbon dioxide. So, using the same thing. So, first you get that alcohol, alcohol can be converted into liquor for human consumption. Alcohol can be converted into industrial use alcohol. Alcohol can be converted into medicinal use alcohol. When we buy cough syrups, it contains alcohol. And therefore, after having cough syrup, we fall sleepy. That's the reason, because it contains alcohol. It's medicinal alcohol. We manufacture ethanol, which is a good fuel. You can manufacture those spirit lamps we used to burn in the science laboratory. Yes. Or when we take injection that doctor applies, that is all been manufactured from here. Your nail polish, right? Remover, not nail polish, that remover, right? That's the same product. Actually, that alcohol can be used. It's a very good cleaning agent. So that wastage, what? Molasses having stinking smell can be converted into variety of products. They said we get good money, we sell it to distillery, therefore we don't throw it. Again, molasses is a byproduct. Molasses is a byproduct. You don't say molasses manufacturing industry, we say sugar industry or sugar factory is the name. In the process of manufacturing sugar, you manufacture bagasse, you manufacture molasses. So they get produced in the process of manufacturing sugar. Sugar is main product. These are byproducts. Now, how to do their accounting? We will be studying here. I think this much is enough, more than enough for the time being. Right? So, one more example clicked to my mind. Most of you must be doing BCom. Most of you, some of you have completed it, so they might be doing MCOM then, right? Those who have come through graduation route. Now, you do BCOM along with CA. Now, you never get a time or a chance to visit the college. It's a fact, because in the morning you are here till evening. When you will go and see the college? When you will come to know about the syllabus? Never. But still, all students doing CA, they get through this BCOM in first class, in first attempt. Isn't it? Yes, because the level of study which you do for CA, using that knowledge you can clear the BCom MCom easily. So I jokingly say, in the process of becoming chartered accountants, you get two more degrees, BCom MCom. So BCom and MCom is a byproduct of doing CA. Isn't it correct? Right. Let's go ahead. Operating costing is the method of costing specially designed for service industry. Operating costing is the method of costing designed exclusively for service industry. And today it's a big industry, service industry. So how to calculate cost of providing services? That will be taught to you in operating costing. Like teaching is a service, hospital service, goods transport, passenger transport, hotels means accommodation, not restaurants, accommodation, hotels, rooms are given on rent. All these are service industries, so many service industries actually. When we provide common services to all customers, services are common, customer has to come and take that service. So when common services are provided to large number of customers, we use operating costing. But when we provide services to individual customer on one-to-one basis, don't forget, I said job costing or jobbing industry is one where goods are manufactured or services are provided as per the specific needs and requirement of customer, then this. But if you are providing same service to all customers, then operating costing, to be discussed in more detail here. Just one more thing recollected in my mind. Some people called process costing as operation costing. What did I say? Operation. And then people confuse this operation and this is almost same. How it is same, my dear friends? Process is called operation. So operation costing and process costing is one and the same. It is for manufacturing industry. Operating costing is service industry. This is for manufacturing industry. This is for service industry. It looks similar. And therefore, this subject has to be studied with lot of attention. I said, no, attendance as well as attention. You will confuse between those. This operation and operating looks similar. Meaning is wide apart. Operation stands for process costing for manufacturing industry. Operating costing stands for service industry. The two separate chapters. Now I come to multiple costing. First of all, there is no method called as multiple costing. What did I say? No method called multiple costing, and I have written a name there. Very good. There is no separate method called multiple costing. However, when we make use of multiple methods means method 1 to 7. When we make use of multiple methods in one company, it means that company is said to be using multiple methods of costing, means multiple costing. Really speaking, it is use of multiple methods of costing. But in brief, it is called multiple costing. So there is no separate method. Methods are 1 to 7 only. But when you use more than one method together, then you are said to be using multiple costing. Is that clear? Let's take an example. In which industry this multiple costing might be used? It means multiple methods of costings are used. Generally, assembly line industry. Again, new word. Assembly line industry. In assembly line industry, we use multiple costing. So, first of all, I have to explain what is assembly line. Now you will come to know the importance, how to use YouTube, because manufacturing industry and we no connection. It means you have to now spare time. I will keep saying this, whether you like it or not. How to find time? Time is going to be very important resource for CA students. You are going to fall short of time. Syllabus is vast, width and depth, both are there, right, in CA syllabus. That's a fact. But it is possible, I said. It is difficult but possible. Withdraw time from WhatsApp, Facebook and all other areas where time is getting wasted. You have to do the analysis. Give time there, but the proportion of time will now change. There has to be some entertainment in life, connection with friends, it is required. But now I think 80 to 90% time will come to your studies of CA. And in 10-20% you have to manage everything else. So only change the proportion. Earlier it was 80% social media, 20% study. Change the ratio. Anyway, so lot of work I am giving to you in free time to do whenever you are sitting. Even if you are sitting in the doctor's clinic waiting for your turn to come, instead of wasting the time, check one of the industry on YouTube. Assembly line industry. Let's come to the point. Is any industry where components and parts are first produced, components and parts are first produced and then they are joined together. This joining is called, very good, joining is called assembly. This joining together is called assembly. And already the example came from here. Automobile industry is one very big example of assembly line industry. Automobile industries, who manufacture scooters, cars, trucks, buses. Automobile word at least you know, I hope. Right? Otherwise, everything will be new. And everything will be difficult. I need everything connected with business world for this subject. You may be having huge knowledge, but I want the knowledge related to business now. Right? Which dress Ranveer Kapoor is wearing today, you might be updated. And what Deepika Padukone is wearing today or not wearing today, you might be updated. Right? That you might be updated, but that type of knowledge we don't need here. Change your areas of interest. Change your areas of interest. What is happening in business? Who has issued equity shares today? Who has issued bonus shares today? Which two companies got merged today? This is the information you should search now, or you should start searching now, because you are on the journey of becoming chartered accountant. So the way you collect the information should change. There is an ocean of information today available due to internet. It's information overload, we say. It's information overload. We are in the era of information overload. You have to select what is required for you, what is important for you. So now start seeking the information related to business activities, business related words, all this. This will keep adding to your knowledge, day to day knowledge. And therefore, I had told you, what extra efforts you take is going to make the difference. I'm going to deal with the subject, no doubt about it. But these extra things and extra efforts and your utilization of time is going to decide your success. Come back. Automobile industry. Because I have seen somewhere question mark when I said automobile. So even word automobile could be a problem for someone. Two-wheeler, three-wheelers, cars, trucks, everything is automobile industry. We'll imagine one truck in front of your eyes. To manufacture that truck, how many components and parts might be required? Thousands. Thousands of components parts. If you want to check exactly how much, then do one thing today. Go to your home today in the evening and open your two-wheeler. Open it up. That is called disassembly. Count how many parts are there. Then assemble. Assembly you cannot do. Anyway, jokingly said, thousands of parts and components are required. So these parts and components are either manufactured, or some of them are manufactured, some of them are purchased from outside, and then they are assembled. Actually, there is called assembly line. There is something called assembly line on which these parts and components are assembled. So let's imagine truck getting manufactured at Tata Motors. Truck is getting manufactured at Tata Motors. And this row is called assembly line. On this row, the chassis of the truck moves. Chassis, you know, the only structure, steel structure of the truck, chassis. It is called CHASIS. Chassis moves here. Workers are sitting on both the sides. They are having parts and components with them. Chassis moves. They keep attaching the parts and components from both the sides. A particular sequence is decided. First, what is to be attached, then next, what is to be attached. There is a sequence. So the chassis moves on the assembly line. Both the side workers, they keep attaching the components and parts. At the end of the assembly line, all parts, components are attached. The truck rolls out. Chassis enters. At the end of assembly line, truck is ready. All automobile industries follow this assembly line. And this assembly line was invented by Ford Motors. First time in automobile industry, assembly line was launched by Ford Motors USA. They introduced this concept, and that concept of more than 100-150 years is still continuing in automobile industry. All automobile industries are using assembly line manufacturing. Only workers are getting replaced by robots nowadays. It is becoming more mechanical. And robots are replacing the worker. So robots are attaching and doing. They are being programmed. So that is the, if you see on YouTube, the Nano Factory is located in Gujarat, Sanand. S-A-N-A-N-D is the name of that city, Sanand. It's a complete robotic factory. The speed of manufacture of car is 1 per minute. What did I say? One per minute means one car gets produced in 1 minute. I am not joking. Neither I lie. Verify it on YouTube. Today nobody can lie because everything is available on Google and YouTube. You can cross check. You can see the entire process of nano factory available on factory made. How the painting is done to that nano car? Painting is to be done. That robotic hand picks up the entire body, dips it into the paint tank. Over. 1 second. It is dipped. Over. So, no need to keep painting like this. Gone are those days. There is a paint tank. The body is dipped into it and sent to the oven. Oven means to get it dried. And the paint gets fixed. One after another. The speed of manufacture is one car per minute. Automated factory. Anyway, come back. Where? Assembly line. I took you elsewhere. All assembly line industry use multiple costing. Why? We'll come to it. First, I made you to imagine. Another assembly line industry is electronic goods. Your mobile. This mobile consists of lot many parts, components, laptop, refrigerator, yes, washing machine, television, projector, yes, all these are assembly line industries where component parts are produced, they are assembled to manufacture finished product. Even bicycle, nobody uses bicycle nowadays. If you go to bicycle shopkeeper for purchase of bicycle, he'll tell you to wait for a few minutes. He has got all parts components. He assembles and gives it to you. Yes, it's a assembly line industry basically. Now, we go back to that example of truck. Why we have to use multiple methods of costing in assembly line? It is possible that some components required in that truck, I am manufacturing in batches. Possible. So, to calculate cost of that component, I have to use batch costing. Because some parts are manufactured in batches. Some parts components might be manufactured through processing. So, I have to use process costing. Engines are manufactured one by one, suppose. So, I may have to use job costing one by one, one by one. Each engine has a number, distinct number, which is written on your registration certificate. Because your vehicle is identifiable through engine number and chassis number. It means I cannot rely on only one method in such a big industry. The industry is so huge, automobile industry, that I cannot rely on one method. So, I have to use 2-3 methods in combination to calculate cost of a truck. And therefore, we say that they are using multiple costing, that is multiple methods of costing. Another example I'll give, hospital. In hospital, we use a combination of operating costing and job costing. Imagine, next time when you go to a hospital, one should not, but then if you happen to go there and if you happen to settle the bill at the end when the patient takes discharge, see that process. Because before giving the discharge, you have to make a final bill and patient has taken the services from variety of departments. They might be having medical store, they might be having X-ray machines, MRI machine, right? Pathological lab in big hospitals. And you have used the services of each and every department or some of the departments. So, from every department comes your bill. And then it gets consolidated and the receptionist will tell you this is the total bill, pay and then take a discharge. Isn't it? Now, in hospitals, some services are common and some services are provided on one-to-one basis. It means they have to maintain record patient-wise also. Patient-wise record means job costing. Because you have to maintain patient-wise record. How much service this patient has taken? How much medicine this patient has used? Which doctor has performed? Which type of operation on that patient? So, doctor's fees is to be charged. And there are some services which are common provided to all patients. Common services like your bed, that is a room which you have hired, right? That is common. The administration is common. E-table services might be common. right? In hospital, they provide you the dress, right? Special purpose dress. So some services are common for all, and some services are provided on one-to-one basis. They have to combine these two. For common services, operating costing. One-to-one services, job costing. And using two together, they deliver you the bill. So they are using again multiple methods. Last example I'll take here. Academy. In academy, how we can use multiple costing if you wish to. Suppose we want to maintain the record of CPT or foundation students, intermediate students, final students. How much cost is incurred on this, this and this? Process costing. Isn't it? Three processes. If we maintain record like this, we don't maintain. But if we maintain, then process costing. Generally, and we are into service industry, means we have to use operating costing also. It's already a service industry, common services provided to all. Plus, suppose we start maintaining the record batch wise to calculate how much cost is incurred on your batch. Then we'll have to also maintain record batch wise if we are interested in knowing. Then we'll have to maintain batch costing also. And suppose sometimes later in few years we start providing home tuitions. It means tuitions at doorstep. A teacher will come and will teach as per your need and requirement. Can become job costing also. So it depends how you want to calculate the cost, whether you are interested in calculating cost of a job or a batch, or whether you want to do it for all together, then multiple costing. Anyway, this was first introduction. Don't worry, all these are our chapters. Now I take you to techniques of costing. I'll discuss three prominent techniques of costing today. Three prominent techniques of costing. Marginal costing, standard costing. I am discussing three prominent techniques: budget and budgetary control. Budget and budgetary control. And we have to see the difference between methods and techniques. There is some difference between methods and techniques of costing. Marginal costing is a technique which is used for, the use of this technique is for decision making. It's a very interesting chapter where you have to apply a lot of brain. Everywhere you have to apply brain in costing, but in this chapter you have to apply more of your brain. It's used for decision making. A businessman has to take variety of business decisions, and generally all decisions are oriented towards minimization of cost and maximization of profit. Naturally, out of the given choices, you have to select the choice where cost is minimum, profit is maximum. This decision making can be done through a technique called marginal costing. Is a technique. Standard costing is a technique used for cost control. This technique is used for keeping control over the cost. It's a cost control technique. We say marginal costing is a decision making technique. Standard costing is a cost control technique. And budget and budgetary control is for overall managerial control. Overall managerial control. It means if you want to run the whole organization in a well coordinated manner, then you have to use budget and budgetary control. And I think everyone would like to run the organization in a well planned manner, in a well coordinated fashion. Every organization. So this is required in every organization. All organizations have to follow these three techniques. Because every organization have to keep the control over cost, they have to take business decisions, and they have to manage the entire show. Overall managerial control can be exercised through budget and budgetary control. Now let us discuss the difference between the two. This is over. Writing work. See the purpose of this. Purpose of methods is to ascertain cost. Yeah. Here the purpose is just to calculate the cost. Here the purposes I have written. These are the objectives or purposes. So, purposes are different. Secondly, this is majorly your intermediate syllabus, this one. This is your CA final syllabus. Anyway, this will be taught to you here also, but at an introductory level. Means you will get introduced to these three chapters. These three chapters in greater details you have to study in CA final. Methods are used by lower level management because this is related to accounting. And these techniques are required for top level management. This work, cost control, decision making, overall organizational control, this is handled by whom? Top level people. So, these techniques are for top level management. This is for lower level, middle level management. When you say the word cost accounting, this is cost accounting. This is another word, management accounting. It is this. These techniques are known as management accounting techniques because they are required by top management for decision making, for cost control, for overall managerial control. And now see the name of your syllabus, correct name of your subject. Cost and management accounting. It is actually cost accounting and management accounting. My dear friends, this is in front of you. This is cost accounting and this is your management accounting. This is your syllabus. Cost and management accounting. So, the purpose is different. This is low level means micro level management. You say micro and macro economics?
Yes.
This is micro level management. This is macro level management. Right? And therefore, this requires more brain. When you become chartered accountant and join an organization, in earlier years, you'll be handling this. Once you become senior, you have to deal with this. Because once you reach to higher level management, and you don't have to do the work of accounting. That will be taken care by the juniors. This is the difference between methods and techniques. And now, I'll take you back. I told you that I'll be giving you 4 volumes of notes, out of which 4th is a just practice manual. But first 3 modules is this. First module, I have given a name, prime cost and overheads. Most of you are having it in your hands. This prime cost and overheads means material and labor is prime cost, practically, 3 elements of cost and overheads. This is in first volume. Prime cost and overheads means material, labor and overheads are next 3 chapters. Those who have, you can check the index. We are at present on first chapter, basic cost concepts. Next chapter is material cost. Next chapter is labor cost or employee cost, it is called as. Next chapter is overheads. You will find one more chapter, activity based costing. Those who are having notes, don't worry, activity based costing is overheads only. Activity based costing is overheads only, but it is classified as a separate chapter by institute, so I have also classified, but it is overheads only, activity based costing. Remaining 2 is just your planning, I think. Some details of video lectures and some planning for CA intermediate, I had told you on day 1. How to plan for your entire journey that has been given there, right? So, those are not your chapters basically. So, first volume is prime cost and overheads. Second volume I have given the name, which will be given to you in due course of time. Second volume is methods of costing. Third volume I have named techniques of costing. That is how I have divided the whole syllabus in 3 parts, 3 prominent parts, prime cost and overheads, methods of costing and techniques of costing. That covers your entire syllabus. And this is the way we will proceed slowly from prime cost and overheads to methods to techniques. Now we go further. This was just first introduction of entire syllabus. If somebody tells me that, sir, in 1 or 2 lectures finish entire costing, then this is the way. So I have introduced you to entire syllabus now. One more chapter is there, I'll just name it, that I have included in last, techniques, but it is not a technique basically, but I have included a chapter here. So once I utter the name of that chapter, full costing is been introduced to you. Pehli mulaqat, huh? Then later on we have to do the expertise in each of them, because all these are different chapters. One more chapter left is accounting, ledger accounting. Like you do it in accounts, you prepare the ledger accounts. So there is cost ledger accounting. In costing also you have to maintain the ledger accounts on debit credit format using double entry bookkeeping system. So that chapter called cost ledger accounting I have included here in techniques. So along with techniques I have included one more chapter, because you have to maintain the record somewhere, no? Whatever cost is incurred, you have to record it somewhere. So that record, bookkeeping recording, but in costing books. So there are separate cost ledger accounting. As you have financial accounting books, on same lines you prepare cost ledger accounting in on double entry bookkeeping system. But there are two separate books, financial accounting separate, cost accounting separate. Why separate? Because there are certain transactions which may be recorded in financial accounting or financial books are not recorded in costing. And there are certain transactions recorded in costing but not recorded in financial. It is all there to be studied in that chapter called cost ledger accounting. And in that chapter, we will also be studying reconciliation of these two profits. As I told you, that there could be some transactions recorded here but not here, or recorded here but not here. Don't you think that profit under the two books of account will be different?
Yes.
Naturally, it will be different. So, profit calculated in financial account and profit calculated as per cost accounting record may differ. So, you have to also study the reconciliation, why there is a difference between the two. You have to reconcile the difference between profit as per cost records and financial records. This will be studying in a chapter called cost ledger accounting. So, I'll utter one more sentence now. Some people having brain, they said, why to maintain this books and this books, two sets of books, double work, and then two profits, then do the reconciliation. Instead of that, let us merge two records. Yeah, it means merge financial accounting and cost accounting together. Both are based on double entry and you have to prepare ledger account only. So, can't you merge both in such a manner that all requirement of financial accounting and cost accounting gets completed in only one set of books of accounts? So, they thought about it and then emerged a new method of accounting called integrated accounting system. Integrated, name contains the meaning. Financial and costing books are integrated into one. So, integrated accounting system also will be studying there. It means in that chapter, we will be studying cost ledger accounting, means only costing records. Then integrated accounting, costing and financial merged. And third, reconciliation of profit as per costing records and financial records. But it's not a technique, it is just bookkeeping, it is just accounting. But I have included that chapter in third volume, because there were only three chapters, so I have included that also. So, this is your first introduction of entire costing. Now, we go to importance of costing. Those who are having copies of notes, check the first page. First page for importance of costing. I have given one table of three products ABC, is it? It must be there. Now, give me that example again to explain the importance of costing or cost accounting. There are three products A, B, C and total. Is it printed? Give me the figure of sales. 1,25,000. 75,000, 50,000, 2 lakh, 50,000. Okay. Give me total cost here. 2 lakh. 2 lakh. And profit?
50,000. Okay. Now check here. In financial books, which you have been preparing since 11th standard, financial accounting, can you calculate product-wise profit? Have you been taught to calculate product-wise profit? Naturally not. In your profit and loss account, which you prepare to calculate the profit, you get the profit for entire organization, is it? So assume this total figures are obtained from financial books. Your financial record P&L account is showing total sales 2,50,000, total cost 2 lakh, profit 50,000. Only this much view will be provided by financial books. Okay. And naturally you are making profit 50,000 on sales 2,50,000. So your profit to sales ratio, if you have studied, it is called net profit ratio, no? Profit divided by sales into 100. You should know 2-3 topics very nicely. Your percentage calculation, percentage ratio proportion, right, and little bit of probability. We need it. I think I told you on day one, we need maths and English basics. I don't need trigonometry calculus, derivatives. I don't need that. Basic maths I need. Basic English I need. This ratio, profitability ratio will be 50 upon 250, 1/5, that is 20%. I can call it as net profit ratio. Now, naturally, any company or organization will be happy with this 20% net profit ratio. First of all, company is in profit, and profit ratio to sales, profit to sales ratio is 20%. This is the view provided by financial books. But in costing, we maintain detailed records. We can calculate product-wise cost, we can calculate process-wise cost, job-wise, batch-wise, in all manners. That is the basic purpose of costing. So, costing will provide you some extra information. Now, this information, cost of product A, B, C is provided by costing records. Give it to me. 1,30,000. Okay. 50,000. 20,000. Okay. So, the profit is now, profit oblique, I will say loss. Here I am suffering a loss of 5,000. Here 25,000 profit, 30,000 profit. So this information is provided to me by costing records. Costing record will tell me which product I am earning profit and on which product I am suffering loss. It indirectly means costing provides you the information about where you are doing the work efficiently and where you are doing the work inefficiently. This extra information is provided by costing. Using this record, if I come to know that this product is a loss-making product, management can take a decision based on this information. Information will be provided by costing records. But this information will be used by management for decision-making, cost control, overall managerial control. Okay, one more thing clicked to my mind, it is still on the board. One more difference was left to be discussed. Methods are industry specific. Industry specific means you will apply a particular method in a particular industry. If I am a contractor, I will use this. I cannot use this. Right? If I am a sugar factory, I have to use process costing. I cannot use job costing. So, methods are industry specific. Techniques are general in nature. Yes. These techniques can be applied in any industry. These techniques can be applied in every industry, any industry. So, techniques are general in nature. Methods are specific in nature. They are designed for specific industry. And you can use any of these techniques along with any of these methods. It is said techniques can be used in conjunction with methods. Because methods are first required to produce the accounting records. You should have information first, job wise, batch wise. So, on the basis of this information, you can apply this. So, all techniques require at the base these methods.
So, techniques go nicely along with any of the methods, or techniques can be used along with or in conjunction with methods of costing. Anyway, now I am coming back. If you have maintained this record and this record shows that product A is suffering a loss, then management will take a decision to drop product A. So, we will drop this product. We will stop manufacturing A, we will manufacture only B and C. Now, see what will happen if we start manufacturing C. Our earlier profit was 50,000. Now, what will happen? Your total sales is 1,25,000. Total cost? And what is total profit? 50. Has profit gone up? And what has happened to this profit ratio now? Tell me. Calculator, 55,000 divided by 1,25,000 into 100, 44% exact. Okay. Your profitability ratio has improved from 20% to 44% due to that decision. That is the benefit of costing. Now, I will utter a sentence. Limitations of financial accounting gave birth to cost accounting. I will repeat. Limitations or drawbacks of financial accounting gave birth to cost accounting. The limitation of financial accounting was, it will provide you the record only for the entire organization. It will show you the picture of the entire organization. But it cannot show you the picture department wise, process wise, job wise. That was limitation of financial accounting. And for taking business decision, you need this detailed information, which was not available in financial books. So, limitation of financial accounting gave birth to cost accounting. And I will utter further sentence, limitation of cost accounting gave birth to management accounting. Techniques of costing is basically management accounting syllabus. Because this helped you to only maintain the records. But you need this also, decision making, cost control, overall managerial control. This was not handled by only accounting. So, limitation of cost accounting gave birth to management accounting, and these are the three branches of accounting, my dear friends. These are three branches of accounting. One branch is financial accounting, another branch is cost accounting, third branch is management accounting. For your information, in the notes I have already written the difference between financial accounting, cost accounting. You can go through it today at home. I have already written the difference between cost accounting and management accounting. Just in points form, difference between format. It's already written. So you can just go through it. You can just read it. Sometimes a theory question can also come. It comes rarely, but sometimes they can ask you the question, what is the difference between the two? So you'll notice somewhere it is written, difference between cost accounting, financial accounting, difference between cost accounting, management accounting. Is it there? You'll find it somewhere. So this is how it is. Limitation of financial accounting gave birth to cost accounting. Limitation of cost accounting gave birth to management accounting. That is the importance of costing we were talking about. Now, I will take you to different terms related to cost. We will start with that. There is a huge syllabus which I have to handle. So, if you are thinking 10 minutes are left, 12 minutes are left, why this person is not leaving us? I will never leave early. Reason? Huge things to cover. And if I want to give more explanation, then I need time. Otherwise, I'll have to cut short on examples and explanation. That won't be good for you. So, I should describe or explain in as much details as possible. So, we need time. I'm taking you to now different cost concepts. This is over now, right? Cost accounting, management accounting, basic discussion is over. In the same chapter, you'll find a diagram somewhere on page. There is a cost written in between, and variety of costs are written. Chapter number, page number, chapter number 1 only, page number 3. Okay, go to page 3 then. Check a diagram of cost, and you will find that cost
can be analyzed in variety of ways. So we call it as different cost concepts. Variety of ways, same cost can be analyzed, same cost. I'll take one by one. And the explanation is also written on next few pages. On page 4 and 5, you'll find all this explanation is written. Everything is written, don't worry. I'll just start discussing. Keep that chart or flow chart in front of you. That is page number 3. And go to 12 o'clock. What is written there on the top? Time-based cost. So, we'll go to different cost concepts. I'll first take time-based. In time-based cost, means we will classify the cost on the basis of time. I think cost written might be past, present and future. Cost can be classified as past, present and future. We'll discuss this. We'll go one by one. We'll go one by one for discussion clockwise. Cost can also be analyzed or classified based on time horizon. Cost incurred in the past. Past cost, also known as historical cost. Historical cost is more popular word. Historical cost is cost already incurred. Present or current cost. Current cost, present cost is cost incurred now. Future, cost to be incurred in future is future cost. Suppose we want to calculate cost of becoming a chartered accountant for you, cost of becoming a chartered accountant, complete chartered accountant, finished product. Then if you make a list of this cost, it will get classified in 3 parts. Some cost you have already incurred in doing CPT, foundation, something, that is past. Some cost you are incurring now for intermediate, present cost. And some more cost is yet to be incurred for CA final, that is future cost. And if you add all the 3, you will get cost of becoming a chartered accountant. Are you getting it? This is classification of cost on time basis. Go clockwise ahead. Next is clockwise you are going. Clockwise you know. Controllable and uncontrollable or non-controllable cost. So, we will discuss this. Controllable and non-controllable. Non-controllable or uncontrollable. This classification, the English meaning is there, same meaning is there. Cost which is in your control is controllable. Cost which is beyond your control, uncontrollable or non-controllable cost. For example, in the process of becoming chartered accountant, I always take the same example, right, which is around us, so that you can correlate better. In the process of becoming chartered accountant, whatever total cost you will incur, out of that total cost, some cost is controllable, some cost is non-controllable. Means same cost, which earlier I divided as past, present and future, same cost I am again classifying differently as controllable and uncontrollable. Uncontrollable cost is institute's registration fees, exam fees, then you have to do certain courses, orientation, information technology. Is it in your hand to spend that money or not? No, you have to spend that money. It is beyond your control, so that cost is uncontrollable. This coaching which you are joining, is it compulsory? No, it is optional. You can study using the study material of institute at home and get through. There are some students who do it without attending the coaching also. It's not impossible. And in our days, there were no coaching. So, we used to do that way. But in our days, some coaching was available. When my father did CA, there was nothing called coaching. So, they did everything using institute's literature. There was no concept called coaching for CA. In our days, the concept got introduced. So, we had coaching for only few subject, only one teacher, right? And today, multiple teachers, multiple subjects, regular batch, revision batch, crash batch, you name it and it is there, everything is there. Anyway, come back. This coaching fees which you are paying, it is optional, means it is in your control. It is your choice whether that money is to be spent
or not to be spent, this cost is called controllable. But this classification of controllable and uncontrollable cost is useful in here, in standard costing, that is in cost control. At CA final level, this syllabus you have to study at CA final level again. I think I have told you this syllabus is here also, but at introductory level, and in depth at higher level you have to study it in CA final. In CA final, more stress is given in this chapter on controllable and uncontrollable cost, because you want to control the cost, but which cost you can control? Controllable. How you can control uncontrollable cost, tell me. If your parents say, most of you have come from outside, if your parents say that your expenses are higher, because they are sending you money, you are in the hostel, so your expenses are going up, means cost is increasing, cost is beyond control. Now you will say, what can I do? This much is the institute's fees, I don't have a control over it, I have to pay. Can you go and tell institute, we are a group of 10 students. Kuch discount to banta hai. Is it possible? Institute will say, we'll give you the degree also, minus 20% discount. CA degree minus 20% discount. So you can write on your visiting card 80% chartered accountant. Acceptable? You'll say, no. Institute will say, pay full fees. It's beyond your control. What is in control is tuition fees, food, traveling. So cost can be controlled, but where? Only those costs can be controlled which are controllable. So don't think about uncontrollable. Next classification. Normality based. So I will say normal cost versus abnormal cost. I'll discuss this and then I'll stop today after this. But this is very important. Try to understand for you, because this will be useful in final. This is useful now. Useful in accounting, main syllabus. Normal versus abnormal cost. Normal costs are those which are normally incurred to run the business. Any cost which you imagine which is required to run the day-to-day business is normal cost, which is expected to be incurred. Any cost which was not expected to be incurred to do that business is called abnormal cost. You have to imagine which costs are required to do that business, whichever you are doing, which is generally required. Like you have to purchase material, you have to pay the employees, you have to pay electricity bill, you have to pay rent and so on. Whatever costs are generally incurred to run a business is normal. Whichever cost you think was not required, but that cost is incurred, though it was not required to run the business, all such costs are called abnormal. This classification is very important because normal cost is included in your cost of production, or I would say cost of that product which you are manufacturing. Yesterday we had given one name, cost object. That is the goods or service whose cost is required to be calculated. So this cost is included in the cost of that cost object, means the product or service which you are providing to the customer. In calculation of that cost, all normal costs are included. But abnormal costs are not included in calculation of cost of product. Abnormal costs are directly debited to costing profit and loss account. Means they are not included in calculation of product cost. There is a difference between this. See, when we will prepare that profit and loss account, in profit and loss account, profit will come as sales minus cost of goods sold, that is cost of sales, cost sheet. Sales minus cost of sales is also profit. But when you calculate that profit, you will take sales revenue, and in cost of sales is calculated for that product. In that cost of sales, you will include only normal cost, not abnormal. Then where the abnormal cost will go? it will directly go to P&L. It means any item which is directly transferred to P&L will not affect the calculation of product cost, but it will affect the organization's profit, because P&L is prepared for the whole organization. And why it is done? This is something common in all chapters, please remember, distinguishing the normal and abnormal. I'll give examples so that clarity will be better. Suppose in your factory there was a fire and goods are destroyed by fire and there is a huge loss. In accounts also you treat it as abnormal. So debit it directly to P&L. We call it as abnormal loss or abnormal cost. So it's an abnormal event which was not expected to happen. Another example, let's try to understand. One more. You are eggs dealer. Eggs. You deal in eggs. You buy and sell eggs. Just a trading activity. Now, eggs is a delicate item. In the transportation, in storage, it may get broken. Some eggs may get rotten. Right? But that is normal loss related to that business, because the in business of eggs, some breakage, some spoilage is going to take place. That loss is normal, which we will suitably adjust. We will see the technique. We will suitably adjust in product cost. But one day, a tempo which was carrying eggs, it met with an accident and the whole tempo turned down and all the eggs in the tempo got converted into omelette. Now, this was not expected. This loss is abnormal loss. Abnormal loss is kept away from the product cost. Reason, we generally compare the product cost. I may compare my own cost of this year with next year to understand whether I am doing right or wrong. Or I may compare cost of my product with a similar product manufactured by my competitor to do the logical comparison. So when you do the comparison of product cost, you should consider only which cost? Normal. If in one particular year I have suffered abnormal loss and that loss also I have included in calculation of cost of product, I think the comparison will become meaningless. Comparison will become meaningless. So abnormal things are removed, taken away from calculation of product cost and directly transferred to profit and loss account. Abnormal losses are also transferred to P&L, and if there is abnormal gain which was not expected, that is also transferred to P&L. So this difference is very, very common throughout costing, normal, abnormal. We'll deal with this more when we start with these chapters. For today, this is enough. So we'll stop here for the day.